Hello, and welcome to the Georgia State Capitol. Today, we're going to talk about Georgia's traveling state capitals. Did you know that this building was not the state's first capital? Georgia began as a colony in 1733, at which time James Edward Oglethorpe established the first city in Georgia, the city of Savannah. Savannah did not become the official colonial seat of government until 1754, when the Board of Trustees in England handed over power to the new royal governor and legislative assembly. As unrest in the colonies grew, Savannah became a center for those who wanted independence from Britain. When Georgia's revolutionaries signed the Declaration of Independence in 1776, they wanted to use Savannah as the state capital too. However, during the Revolutionary War, the capital moved around a lot. The British took Savannah in 1778 and continued fighting their way inland from Georgia's coast. The fighting forced the state capital to move from Savannah in 1776 to Augusta in 1778 to Hurd's Fort in Wilkes County in 1780. Because the British were so active in Georgia, the Legislative Assembly, which at the time was the entire state government, had to stay on the move. There's very little record of where they actually were for a whole year. Our best guess is that they moved around Wilkes County, but they may have even gone into South Carolina to conduct business. By 1781, they were able to reconvene in Augusta and elect a governor. By 1782, the British left Savannah, and the state government moved back in. After the war ended and Georgia won its independence from Britain, settlers further inland made it very clear they did not want a capital in Savannah. It was too far away, and because the population was expanding inland, that was not going to get any better. As you already know, communication at this time was not easy. People couldn't just tweet at their government officials. They had to write letters and hope for a response, or make the long and difficult journey themselves. The citizens became so expressive that the legislature decided in 1785 that all future meetings would be in Augusta, at least until they changed their minds again. Augusta remained the state's capital from 1785 to 1795. The government initially rented Abraham Jones's house for the first year of meetings. While there are no images of this house available, we knew that it was somewhere on the southwestern corner of Broad Street and 3rd Street in Augusta, shown here in a map from 1890. The government soon needed more space and negotiated with Richmond Academy to rent their building. Georgians' issue with Augusta was that it was still too far east. And there were loads of people in the western portion of the state that needed access to government. So the legislature looked for an even more central capital than Augusta, and they decided on Louisville. Louisville is unique in that it was the first Georgia capital built with the specific purpose of being a capital city. Georgia's leaders chose the spot for Louisville based on its closeness to the Ogeechee River for transportation. They also based the design on that of Philadelphia, with a raised state house in the center of the city. The closeness to the river meant better access to transportation. It also meant that the population was more vulnerable to malaria outbreaks. The malaria, along with further expansion west after the Compact of 1802, meant that Georgia's government had to plan another move. In 1807, the capital moved to Milledgeville. The city of Milledgeville was also built specifically to be Georgia's capital. At the time, Milledgeville was a more central location and offered protection from potential public health crises. Milledgeville remained the capital throughout the Civil War. However, in the aftermath of the Civil War, Reconstruction-era leadership decided to move the capital to Atlanta. Though Atlanta was not the center of Georgia, it was connected to the state through railroad lines. Transportation was the business that Atlanta was built on, and the city quickly became Georgia's industrial center because of the railroads. Another advantage Atlanta had was its newness. Leaders of Georgia no longer wanted to be associated with the antebellum South. They wanted to build a new South, one that was more industrial and less agricultural than the past. One of Atlanta's biggest cheerleaders was businessman Henry Grady. In a speech he gave to the banquet of the New England Club in New York, he expressed the imagery of the New South. He began by quoting Benjamin Hill, a New York politician of the late 1800s, and said, quote, There was a South of slavery and secession. That South is dead. There is a South of union and freedom. That South, thank God, is living, breathing, growing every hour. Though this may make it seem like oppression disappeared overnight for all Southerners, it's very important to remember that African Americans in the South were still treated as second-class citizens, and would be for some time. While Grady made claims about what the New South is and how the New South should deal with the North, he made the goal of his speech very clear at the end, quote, "Now, what answer has New England to this message? Will she permit the prejudice of war to remain in the hearts of the conquerors when it has died in the hearts of the conquered?" All that is to say, Henry Grady wanted the North and South to make up, and he was willing to tell Northern investors exactly what they wanted to hear to bring money back into Atlanta. The idea of the New South was an effort to rebrand the Southern states to make them more marketable to Northern investors. Atlanta as the capital, along with Atlanta's new Capitol building, was all a part of this plan. For many Georgians, Milledgeville was too big a symbol of antebellum Georgia, the way that Georgia was before the Civil War, whereas Atlanta symbolized all that Georgia could become if given the chance. Georgia's leaders built a brand new state house with modern fireproofing and all of the latest 19th century technology. Though Georgia has seen many changes since 1868, Atlanta has remained the state's capital. The executive offices of the governor, lieutenant governor, and secretary of state operate out of the historic building, and legislators still meet in the historic galleries. Though the Supreme Court used to operate from this building, it's since found a much larger home across Capitol Avenue. Our next video will talk about how the state government works in our capital. The sources for this video can be found in the description box. Thank you for joining us.